If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this extra handsome episode of Mind Pump, for the first 46 minutes, we do our introductory conversation. We talk about how Netflix stock dropped like 14 points, right? Went down a lot, quite a bit. Then we talk about Adam's Everlywell boo-boo. He had a little owie on his finger from taking
He doesn't like those little pricks.
Omega 3. Yeah, he likes the big ones.
Yeah.
Omega 3 test. We are sponsored by Everlywell, so we got you guys a discount. If you go to everlywell.com, enter the code MINDPUMP, you'll get 15% off any of the tests. Then Justin talks about changing his dog's dog food and found some from Thrive Market. Now, Thrive Market is the largest online retailer of non-GMO organic products, including skincare products, including food products, including cleaning products.
Pretty much everything you're going to need or want.
Even products for your skin. This is where you can get your deodorant, your skincare.
Do we still have some listeners that don't use Thrive?
Dude, it is the discounts on there are phenomenal. You'll buy things for the same price as you'll get them. They're conventional counterpart. So things that are non-organic, in other words. Great place to go. If you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, we got you a massive, massive discount and deal. Here's what you're going to get. 1 month for free, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and free shipping. Then we talked about the studies that showed that you can actually erase particular memories in mice. It's a little scary. CIA is probably doing that right now.
Yeah. I'm sure they are.
We talked about how paleo now includes bread. That's right.
What?
Find out in this episode what the hell I'm talking about.
Oh my God, bread's so paleo?
Yep. Then we talk about Johnson & Johnson's baby powder. They just lost a major lawsuit causing ovarian cancer. That's crazy.
Yeah, stop. Let's put asbestos in there. Yeah,
gotta stop putting it on my balls now.
Yeah, you let them sweat a little bit. Mm-hmm. Then we talked about fecal transplants and autism. Studies showed that kids getting fecal transplants from people with healthy guts dramatically reduce their symptoms of autism. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, can you build your muscles but not get stronger? Kind of a weird question, but it's also a good one. We get into an interesting discussion in that part of this episode. The next question was, what is the worst injury that we've ever experienced and what did we do to recover from it? The next question was, what do we think about the latest steroid use scandals in CrossFit? They're now testing their athletes. They've banned a few of them. They're pretty strict. Do we think it's going to hurt or help the growth of the sport? And finally, the last question, what are some of our favorite functional, in quotation marks, exercises for experienced lifters who want to get more into that kind of training? Also, I want to remind everybody that this month, the Foundational MAPS program, the best muscle building, strength building, and metabolism boosting program that we offer, MAPS Anabolic, is 50% off. So we took the total price, cut it in half. It's under $60. You get full access, by the way. You get the same thing you would get at full price, so full access. You can find that at mindpumpmedia.com. That promotion is until this month. So at the end of this month, it'll be ending. We also have bundles. This is where we combine multiple MAPS programs and discount them for particular goals. Like we have a sexy athlete bundle. We have a build your butt bundle. We also have a super bundle. This is a year of exercise programs. So a full year planned out for you. That's the super bundle. You can find all the bundles and MAPS Anabolic at mindpumpmedia.com.
Did you call Justin, or did you guys, you know, the shirt thing? Is that something that you guys have been planning a lot lately?
Oh, Doug and Justin are wearing a shirt together.
Yeah.
Hey, yesterday it was you and Doug, so
well,
I felt left out.
I feel like Doug's being a shirt whore right now. Make up your mind, Doug. You either dress like
which
me.
Which team are you?
Or like Justin.
Yeah.
I'm not
I
trying
actually
to
really like, I don't have any of the Stay Authentic ones like these.
Those are the best ones.
They are the best ones. They're the most like.
I would actually I'd wear them.
They're like classic style. Yeah. We need to do more of these
with jeans or whatever.
I'm surprised those didn't sell as crazy as I would have thought. Like they didn't do that great.
Yeah. I don't know.
Did we sell out of them?
No.
We still have them?
Yeah, we go.
Those are the best looking ones.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, by far. Yeah, I like the blue one the most.
And I like Stay Authentic too. I just like the saying. I really like the
right. But it's assuming someone's authentic to begin with. Maybe that's the problem.
That's why nobody's everyone's
criminals out there.
Yeah, this,
bunch
of they didn't sell out.
Shysters.
Didn't sell out because a bunch of fake motherfuckers out there.
Like, oh, I can't stay authentic.
You know what? I'm okay with shreds. You know, that, like staying authentic. Yeah.
I like beast gross. Mode.
Yeah, beast mode. Yeah. Maybe. Kill everything.
Oh, dude, that's such a funny. Oh, who came up with that term, beast mode?
You don't know where that's from?
No. With the original? Where did it come from?
It's trademarked, dude. It's trademarked by fucking, what's his face? By beast mode. By Marshawn Lynch.
Oh.
Yeah.
Turn on beast mode.
Yeah, there's a whole thing behind it. Like when they started calling him that back, I believe it started all the way back to when he was high school. So his buddy, he has a high school buddy, which by the way, when I met him,
did he play for the Seahawks?
Yes.
Damn.
Yeah. Oh. He actually still is in the NFL right now.
Where's he at? He's the guy with the dreadlocks, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah, he's got long hair.
Dang.
Where's he at?
Huh?
Where's he at now?
NFL.
He plays for the Raiders now.
I was going to say the Raiders.
But yeah. Or is that what you were going to say?
Yeah,
you were on a roll there.
So anyway,
the Cincinnati Raiders.
So check this out. So
Cincinnati.
The story goes that in high school, they used to say, his buddy used to say that, but they're like high school buddies used to say that. And as he started to blow up, they started to make t-shirts and people were starting to make banners and they were giving him Skittles. That was that whole thing. And
Skittles? What? Hold on.
Yeah. So that was like there was this thing that he used to eat Skittles before every game.
Oh, okay.
So people in Seattle would throw Skittles on the field and stuff when he'd come out and shit.
Oh, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. Hey, I learned a
taste
new
the rainbow.
I learned a new urban dictionary word.
Say it.
I'm not going to define it. You have to look it up for yourself.
Wait. Can we guess? Like what the definition
is? You got to guess.
Let's do this. I'll play this.
Bro,
game.
Bro, I died when I heard this for the first time. Wizard sleeve.
That's gotta be an uncircumcised shaft.
No, it's a condom.
No.
It's a condom. No, it's not a condom.
No,
a wizard sleeve.
No.
What is it? Let me look.
Well, now you see me, now you don't. No, that's why I'm thinking like you're uncircumcised.
No. Picture what a wizard sleeve looks like. You know what I mean?
When it's hanging down like a triangle and flappy.
Yeah.
Of vagina. It's a vagina, isn't it?
Did Justin get it?
He did.
Wow. Yes. That is really good, Justin.
Yeah.
Well, think about it. It's like triangular.
Yeah, and it's just kind of like a big wizard sleeve.
I have never heard that being referenced.
Bro, isn't that the best thing you've ever heard in your life?
Wizard sleeve. Making friends with the wizard sleeve this weekend.
Yeah.
Who told you that?
It was in a text. Wow. I'm in a group text with my cousins and stuff. And all we do on there is... Here's what happens in this group text. They're all investment people. So my cousins, my friends, all of them are investors of some sort, whether they're in real estate or they actually work for banks and they're, you know, what are they called? Investment bankers or whatever. So 99% of it is, you know, this fucking thing is moving this way and the charts show this. And it looks like the Matrix when I look at half the shit. I'm like, I can't read any stuff. And then the other 1% is shit talking.
Speaking of that, did they text about buying Netflix right now?
No.
It's down 14%.
It's down 14%?
Yeah,
what happened?
So Netflix crashed after the first... Well, it didn't crash. It dropped 14 points.
Because of their spending?
They didn't hit their projections for quarter one. They were like off by like over a million subscribers. And so it dropped. Now...
There's more competition.
Well, yeah, dude. I mean, with Disney and Hulu and what we see going on with Prime right now, I mean... The race is on. I tell you what,
I just
a year and a half ago or so, I was a big believer in Netflix. You know,
I still am, dude. I think that they're going to be king.
I don't. You don't want to. You want to know why I'm hesitant to say that now?
Mm-hmm.
Is I've been disappointed in some of the movies they've done.
Ah,
so that was the big thing,
like with Will Smith.
Yeah,
that big.
You know
thing.
What, dude? Did you guys watch that?
That was a flop, dude.
It was good for a second, and then they kind of jumped the shark a little bit, right? And it got kind of bad. They had all the components of what could have been.
Yeah, it could
awesome.
Have been good, but yeah, they blew it.
Now that's a great point, right? So I think this is where the algorithm is just not enough, right? So
I think the writers.
Yeah, I think they did a great job of hacking the algorithm of all the things that you would want, right? I think that's right on point by saying that. Like you're attracted to it because like, man, something about this. I like this. You know, it's funny. It's all kinds of guns and explosive shit. Great actor.
Aliens with Will Smith always tends to work. You know?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's a good formula.
But then it's just like, wah, wah, wah.
Yeah.
You know, just didn't have a crescendo, right? It didn't have something where you're like,
you know what's funny about let's deconstruct that a little bit. So you have Will Smith with Aliens, but also you remember him from Bad Boys. So he was like a cop, mm-hmm. and a detective. And so like he nailed those roles. And so they're like trying to mash all this shit into one movie.
It reminds me of the old, it was an old TV series that was fucking awesome on it was in the 90s, I think it was the 90s or 80s, where one of the cops, it was the almost the exact same story. Aliens came to Earth. We accepted them. And then it's like so many years into that.
Were they bald?
One of them was he's bald.
Yeah,
and he looked
I remember
like he
that.
Had
yeah, the spots on.
Yeah,
him.
He had like the Gorbachev looking, yeah. you know, birthmark things.
I remember
and
that.
They were weird and they drank sour milk. It was called V. I think it was called V.
Yeah,
was that the name
milk.
Of it, Doug? I don't remember.
Yeah.
But anyway, it was the same exact premise. It was almost the same exact premise. And that was a good show.
Mm-hmm.
That show was really good.
I do remember that show.
But I do think that this is where Netflix may not win, dude. Is and for a minute there, we were talking, what, just a year ago or so, we were talking about them kind of taking over Hollywood and kind of blowing it up, right?
Right.
And I had a lot of confidence in what they're doing, but now seeing the movies, and it makes me question, like, okay,
well
if you don't have the writers, if you don't have the real artists, right, that are the creators.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think, that's definitely, like, the Hulu and Disney combo is dangerous.
Right.
That is a huge threat. But I do think they could turn that around just as simple as, like, getting Stephen King's and getting like real writers to come in and like create these movies and storylines for them. But actually, I think they got Stephen King. What was it, like something Castle? Anyway, he's got a new show coming out. I think it's on Hulu. But yeah.
Here's the thing this is what I like about so much about tech is that many times you look at a business that's on top and you think, oh, they're dominating. Nobody could ever overcome them or nobody can beat with them or compete. And we get proven wrong every single time. It's such a competitive market.
Yeah.
Like, good luck trying to dominate and maintain dominance. People are going to be at your heels the entire time. They just are. Mm-hmm. I mean, Amazon did it to Google for searching for products.
Mm-hmm.
Amazon flipped that on its head. People don't realize how big of a deal that was when
crazy.
That happened. So we'll see what happens.
So what we need is competition for Comcast. Come on.
Now, you know why that's bullshit? Do you know why that's so hard to compete? Because they regulate it so much, it's impossible to, like, that's regulated by the phone companies and stuff.
Well, it's like
the FCC
cell phones,
and all
dude.
That.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
It's like, all wrapped into it.
Yeah.
Because, dude, I saw that they're finally, at least, like, Google's, like, taking actual, like, wire and bringing it all the way across to like Spain or whatever, but like so they're actually laying down all the fabric and the fiber optic cable to make it so they can have like, you know, internet capability. But it's like, dude, when like how come it's taking so long, dude? Like they need competition so bad, man. It's just every year they increase their rates for some reason.
Well, you're limited. What's your options?
Yeah, what are you gonna do? It's like AT&T is like dog shit. Like I can't even get that in my area.
Yeah,
so.
We definitely need more competition. Absolutely.
I think it's coming though, don't you? I mean, I think it's only a matter of time. I think.
Well,
I know. I'm just
companies,
I'm antsy, dude.
Well, companies like Facebook have talked about putting blimps in the air to give people free Wi-Fi and, you know, satellite and all these other options. It's happening. There's such a big market for it. And there's how many people are like you?
Yeah.
Think about that, Justin. How many
people
are pissed
jump
off?
Ship immediately. That company can suck it.
Yeah, they're being protected right now by these old archaic laws that make competing with them impossible.
Yeah,
you know, that's the deal.
Dude,
how's your finger doing, Adam? You okay now?
I know. Did you keep that Band-Aid on
We're in this interview. We had Ryan Mickler from Order Man. Great guy, by the way. Fucking love that guy. Yeah. Anyway, we're hanging out with him doing a podcast. Adam's talking and Adam's waving his hands like he normally does. And
waving my hands.
Yeah,
like,
you know, like, hey.
Talk with my hands.
Yeah. So this like Hello Kitty sticker.
Yeah. And I'm like, I'm looking at his finger. I'm like, what happened? He's got like his big old like bandage on his finger. I'm like, damn.
He
must have injured himself.
Okay, so now I this fucker has a nurse for a wife, so I know he didn't do it. Did you do your own?
Yeah.
It's so stupid. It's the easiest thing in the world.
Oh my God. I don't know, dude.
What do you mean you don't know? It's so easy.
It's not a matter of it easy or not.
Were
you
like flinchy? Like, ah.
Well, no. I mean, you see, you saw the Insta story. I mean, Taylor Insta story, the whole thing, me doing it. But there's just something about stabbing yourself. And the way it's designed,
it just does it real quick.
Well, yeah, but you can't see it, right? Yeah. So it's like you can't. I don't know.
It like stamps you.
So right. Yeah. So here's the thing. So
you don't know how big the needle is, or
yeah. And, I don't know how hard. I don't know how hard I gotta push.
Oh, trust me, I'm not.
Dude, yeah. I just rolled my eyes so hard I saw my brain. So we're talking about the Everly Well tests, and some of the tests are saliva, like the testosterone ones that we did.
Yeah.
And some of the tests actually use blood,
yeah,
and
you need blood.
Use a drop of blood. And what they do is they give you this. Little for people who have diabetes, they know exactly what this is. So people with diabetes will use these things all the time because they'll have to test their blood for blood sugar.
Right.
It's this little device, and the needle is literally the smallest needle of all time. It's the size of a fucking...
You could barely even bleed with it.
It's yeah. So yeah.
You have to squeeze it out.
You have to like squeeze and massage your finger.
That's not the point, asshole. That's not the point.
Use a fucking... This guy used a 21 or 22 gauge needle,
shooting
3 inches long, and I put in your ass cheek.
Oh my god!
And you're afraid of a little.
That's such a good point.
Well, let me tell you, there was a fucking learning curve in a while for
really?
That. Oh yeah,
were you scared of that?
Yeah, fuck yeah. No, I remember the first time I had to do that. It took me a while before I got comfortable even doing that.
Did someone else have to do it? For you?
Yeah. No, I had a buddy of mine do that for a long time. Then I had a girlfriend of mine do it for a long time. So I was I didn't like doing that shit either. But that, after a while, I mean, I got used to that, right?
Well, so were you always scared of, like, getting shots and shit as a kid? Was that, like, a big deal for you?
I don't know if I was scared, but I definitely didn't like it. It definitely wasn't something where...
What about when you got to give blood or whatever?
I get lightheaded big time when I give blood.
Wow.
Yeah. Have you ever, like, stared at it when
you're
doing
that? I get hell lightheaded.
You know, that's...
I just don't look at it.
That's an actual phobia.
Yeah, I'm cool. Like, it's weird. Like, I don't get, like, all weird, and I don't get anxiety about it. But when they draw blood, dude, I got to not watch it. If I'm watching it, I get all lightheaded.
You get woozy.
Yeah,
it's funny. Courtney actually almost passed out watching me get my blood drawn.
Oh, dude, I could cut my own arm off. If it didn't hurt, I'd have no problem.
I could cut my own arm off.
Bro, I have no problem with that kind of shit.
Did I tell you I was talking? We won't sell them out.
Before you do, I'm going to tell you a story real quick.
Okay.
When I got my shoulder surgery on my left... When I got my shoulder surgery on my left shoulder, I had my AC joint shaved down a little bit. They had this catheter inside my shoulder that would pump pain medicine to it, and I came home with this little pain pump. I couldn't sleep with that thing. So I came home and I unwrapped everything and I pulled that fucker right out of my arm, this long tube out of my arm.
Mm-hmm.
Blood everywhere. No problem, bro.
Mm.
No problem.
Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah.
The Everly Well test is easy, though.
That catheter out of
it's
my
an
dick.
Easy test.
No, it was. I mean, you watch it. Those that have already seen the story saw me do it.
And this was for omega 3. This is the omega 3 one.
Yeah, I'm
trying to test to see if we're getting adequate omega 3 fatty acids.
Now, I'm going to go ahead and speculate that I'm going to be good. I think I'm going to be, and I don't even know because I haven't seen what the results, like, you know how the testosterone they give you. What I love about,
be a little deficient.
What I love most about this Everly Well test is how simple, like, so once you do the test, whether you do the saliva one or the blood one for the omega, they give you everything you need to ship it. It's pay the shipping, return shipping is in there. You do it all, package up, send it. Well, you register it on the barcode that's on there, which is super easy. And then it automatically text messages me and lets me know, like, when they've received it in the lab, then when they've tested all of it.
Yeah.
And then
they're quick with the results.
Oh, dude, it's so easy.
Once I figured that out.
And now I have a login, and so I can go back, I can review my testosterone, because I want to do the testosterone one again soon.
Yes, I told him I want to do that.
Yeah, just so I can see
I want to see if we can, affect it.
Yeah, I blew the last one.
So you think your omega-3s are going to be low?
I think they may be a little low.
Because
I don't eat fish like you guys, all the time.
Oh, that's right. I forget. You don't like fish so much.
No, uh-huh. I get it.
See, I eat a lot of fish, and if I don't eat fish, I'm aware of it, and I've got omegas at the house.
Yeah, so do I. I should be good. Otherwise, the fish oil that I take is not working.
Yeah, and I have the supplements for it, but I'm bad at it.
Do you take any supplements at all?
Never.
Nothing.
I mean, I do sometimes, like when we're traveling and stuff, but that's about it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, if you were to list down like your top three or five like supplements that were sponsored and not sponsored by, who do you fuck with the most?
I mean, I just, green juice is probably like the only thing I'll do besides, like, I mean, back when I was like training really hard and I was trying to get like serious performance and gains, like I would take some creatine but that was it. That literally is like it.
Yeah. You're probably good with creatine right now because you're eating so much meat.
Yeah, just eating a lot of meat.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. what
I'm using Mike's creatine right now.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I've been using that. Like, there's a couple things I'm doing right now that I just normally wouldn't. I'm not a like...
Because of competition, that's why.
Yeah, that's right. So, Well, and you know what, though? More so than the competition, I don't I don't like throwing supplements on an inconsistent diet and training routine. And people do this all the time. I think it's such a waste of money to me. And for me, it gives me peace of mind when I am training, when I'm dieting right, when I'm training right. Throwing on supplements, I feel like it gives me a better better observation of like what's really going on. You know what I'm saying? Like,
of course.
I just don't like for example,
it's also a waste of time.
You've been talking about the higher dose of turmeric, and so I've been kind of playing with that because, and
I don't think it makes sense to do it when you're eating shitty. You know what I mean? Like, I'm going to take this to lower my inflammation.
Well, even not just shitty. Like, I just think all over the board. If you're inconsistent.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, because somebody's probably listening right now going like, well, I don't eat shitty, but I take all these supplements every day. And it's like, well, fuck, how do you know if they're working?
Well, now here's the thing.
Diet's all over the place.
Now, here's the thing. Turmeric is maybe a little different because it's a food. So you're just adding a food to what you're, you know what I mean? The other stuff I could see, like, when people take individual amino acids. And
even then, like, so the main reason why I'm taking turmeric is I'm trying to see if it's helping keep inflammation down and it's speeding up any sort of recovery process in me lifting and training hard, right? So if I'm eating a bunch of high inflammatory foods, like, is it really going to counter all that? I don't think so. I don't think it's that strong. I don't think it's fucking superpower. You know what I'm saying? I think I...
How's your Achilles right now with everything?
We haven't brought it. You guys haven't brought it.
Oh, yeah. And your injections.
BPC.
BPC.
Yeah. BPC 5927.
Did you get yours yet?
No. Jordan's supposed to. He said he was going to stop by, but he hasn't.
Way to sell out your drug dealer. Oh. So I got it.
You just right under the bus.
That's right. We know a lot. We know a lot of those. So
oh,
it's
wow. Yeah, there's a lot of Jordans out there. So, Michael Jordan.
Anyways,
it was Michael Jordan, dude.
So
good connection.
I love it, bro. I'm a huge, but here's the thing though, and this is what I'm uncertain of, and I don't know, and I can't wait for you to get it so we can sit here and we can bullshit about it off air and kind of figure this out together. Is I don't know if it's something that's happening instantly. Like we kind of speculated this a little bit. Like, is it something like when I inject it in there, is it like kind of numbing that area?
Yeah.
Because there's already been a couple days where it kind of bothers me a little bit and I feel it kind of coming back. And then I inject that stuff. And then within an hour, like.
Didn't you say too, though, when you're not taking it, how it just immediately all comes back?
Well, so that's what I was saying early on when we the first few injections. But I've been consistent every other day. I think I had a weekend where I stretched 3 days or so of not injecting. In fact, I'm due today, and I'm through the first bottle. I'm on to my second bottle right now, and I feel really good. It's definitely still there. It doesn't feel like it's fucking repaired and recovered everything perfectly. But I'm in the least amount of pain. I feel the best.
That is a good question because is it like taking an anti-inflammatory or it just works acutely, or is it actually speeding up
the recovery
and improving the recovery process?
And so
because anti-inflammatories will make you feel better too, but they do not speed up recovery. In fact, they might even slow it down in some cases.
So and so for me, we're. I think where I'm going to be able to answer this the best is after I've gone through both bottles and then we're, 3-4 weeks down the road after I've been done with it, how do I feel? Do I feel like I've maintained that or I'm getting even better, or am I starting to notice it bother me again? But 100% as of right now, worth it. For sure worth it.
Interesting.
Right now I'm like, okay, I feel the best I've felt since this has been going
just
on.
As a recovery aid, you're like, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
This makes sense.
So it may be like an almost like a, what's the word, unfair advantage for the competition.
Oh, yeah. You just got yours coming. You injected in your face wherever the fuck you want.
No. We didn't talk about drugs.
No. I'm going to wait till after the contest. I want to make sure I compete like totally.
Yeah.
Good, because we're
like
doing
purity.
We're doing a blood test afterwards, just so everybody knows.
Shut up, bro. I'm not doing a blood test afterwards. You're going to find all kinds of weird shit in your.
Yeah, no, it's going to be all skewed.
Yeah.
Dude, I had, so my dog's been like having horrible, horrible diarrhea and like crazy stuff going on.
Oh, does he just do that in the house?
Thankfully, not this time. I told you about that one time where in the middle of the night, he just blasted like the curtains from my closet.
Dude, puppies.
Oh, my God.
stomachs are so sensitive, like to diet and stuff. Like if you change the diet in the slightest bit, like they'll.
So I bought this food, you know, from the grocery store. It was supposed to be the highest quality. It was at like one of those organic, you know, grocery stores. I think it was, I don't know if it was Whole Foods, but anyway, and it's not working. Like he just still has all this like fucking crazy diarrhea and all this stuff going on. So I'm trying this out. I remember you mentioned that Thrive Market has, you know, some food on there. And so I went and checked it out. So I'm trying a new brand out to see how that's going to go. And
what's the brand? Do you remember?
It's like I and Love You. Wait, hold on. I think I remember. It's I and Love and You.
Okay.
Kind of an interesting name. Yeah. But it's,
see if that works.
See if it works.
You can also give your dog probiotics.
That too.
Have you tried that yet?
Yeah.
Oh, has it helped?
A little bit.
Now, how are you giving them probiotics? Are you using the supplement or are you doing yogurt?
Open it and pour it in the
food. I actually give him yogurt. So that's
you can do yogurt.
Yeah, oh, okay.
Yeah, now, unless he's got a dairy intolerance. It's so funny we're talking about a dog.
Yeah.
But it's true.
But they're just, I mean, they're living beings just like us.
No, anytime the dogs get off, like if they get into shit and they eat something bad or someone fed them something that they're not supposed to eat, like I had somebody else watching them, and I know right away because they're so sensitive. And then the next meal or two, I'll feed them cottage cheese or Greek yogurt.
Oh, that's a good call.
With
rice. Try that too.
With a little bit of white rice. Mm.
Have you tried, what happens when you give your dog like meat and stuff like that? Is that easier to digest for a dog?
Yeah, it's easier.
I would assume so. Yeah.
Do you know what meat is the most non-allergenic meat for animals? So like if your animal-
The most non-allergenic food?
Yeah. Do you know?
I think for people too.
Is it for people? Do you know what it is? It's pork.
Oh, pork.
Yeah.
Oh.
Really?
Oh, it's not the same. Oh, I see what you're saying. No. I don't think pork is for people. I think
Like what I've had dogs and cats and stuff like that that have like are super allergic to all kinds of different foods, and so they typically tell you to put them on like an all pork diet for a while, and then after they've been eating that for a while.
Interesting.
I didn't know that.
Of all the meats that can bother me, meats I have a really good tolerance. I can eat meat forever, but the one that if I push too hard, I can sometimes have an issue.
Gargle that meat.
Is actually pork.
Hmm.
Believe it or not, pork actually might bother me. Sometimes bothers me.
Oh,
a
really?
Bit. Yeah. Hmm. Sometimes.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Sits really well with me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Dude, did you? I'm going to ask you, Sal. Did you see the study on the erasing memories in mice?
Oh, a long time ago.
Oh, dude, no, this is new. This is brand new, brother.
So fill me in.
Yeah. Memories can be altered in mice or humans' necks.
That's fucked up.
It says
the CIA hasn't been doing this with us.
You imagine that? Oh, you did kill that person. Oh my God, I did. Go to jail.
Yeah, it's crazy, right? Neuroscientists usually define a singular memory as an engram, engram, a physical change in brain tissue associated with particular recollection. Recently, brain scans revealed that an engram isn't isolated to one region of the brain and instead manifests as a colorful splattering across the neural tissue. And what they're saying is that if they're trying to do it for PTSD and Alzheimer's. Yeah, Alzheimer's.
Dude, that's, you know, have you guys watched the movie, Jim Carrey's in it.
A Beautiful Mind?
No.
Truman?
No. Sunshine
of the Spotless.
Sunshine of the Spotless.
Eternal
mind.
Sunshine. we just pieced that together.
By the way, have you seen that movie?
Yes.
I've never seen
it. I love that movie.
Oh, you've never seen it?
No. Oh, I love that movie.
Oh, bro, you got to watch that with Katrina. Such a well-made movie.
Really? How did I not know
that? It's one of his best ones.
Such a well-made movie.
Yeah.
So good. But anyway.
It's a drama, though.
The premise of it, and I won't do the spoiler. I won't give you a spoiler, but the premise of it is you go to these places and they erase bad memories. So like if you had like a terrible breakup or something traumatic, they'll erase it from your mind and then you don't have it anymore. And so that's what it reminded me of.
So, I mean, that's
also Total Recall. Yeah.
That's the theory on here is that they're going to be able to do that, you know? So how crazy would that be?
That's
scary to give someone that power that could go in and erase one. And you have to ask yourself, would that be ideal? Because it is what shapes us into who we are. But the argument they're saying, and again, for like PTSD or someone like that, that's like, well, if you have these awful traumatic memories that are making you angry, making you depressed.
Is it better to delete it or to deal with it?
That's the question.
Well,
that's the moral question.
Right, which I think I would argue that the overcoming it would be ideal, which is, I mean, that's the alchemist or us talking about it's the journey and it. That's
plus,
really
we don't know
where the magic is at,
and,
right?
And I'm not trying to be insensitive to people with terrible issues.
Yeah.
So I want to be very clear. I have lots of empathy for those. But we really don't know the potential benefits or the ways that it has molded our character to go through these things. So what ends up happening, we have a bad, let's say we have a really bad experience and it's super traumatic. And we just think about it. We mull it over all the time. It causes lots of pain and anxiety. And we erase that. We don't know if alongside that pain and anxiety or whatever, it's also shaped our character and helped us become who we are. And if we erase it, we become someone else.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's kind of an interesting problem, moral problem.
It's interesting too, because I mean, if you get into like some weird stuff like pedophiles and all that, like maybe there was an impressionable thing that happened to them in their childhood that they can delete, and then it like sort of rewires their brain.
I know that I can see the argument going right? in all kinds of different directions.
That's why it's like, I don't know.
This brings me a question that I've always thought about, and you know, a good thing that I want to ask you guys to hear what you guys think. Like, have you guys ever thought back, like when you think back to your deepest memories, like as far back as you go, do you have more memories that you recall that are positive or negative?
This is actually something that they've studied quite a bit in people.
I find that interesting, right? Because I know as a kid, I know that my life wasn't all bad, right? I know that. I remember it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had a great childhood. But I know that we had some dark times and hard times. Unfortunately for me, though, the positive things that probably happened mm-hmm. a lot as a kid are blurry or non-existent for me, where the traumatic type of things that happen,
they stand out more,
are very vivid.
That's normal.
You know what I'm saying?
That's normal, because from an evolutionary standpoint, think about it this way. If something bad happens to you and then something good happens to you, which one's more important to remember, for survival?
Yeah.
For survival. Right. So the brain is kind of designed or evolved to pay attention to the bad, scary shit to keep you alive more than the happy, fuzzy stuff. And so we tend to have memories that way. But also context matters too. So let's say your life is going great right now mm-hmm. and everything's awesome. And let's say you wrote a book or you did something and you talked about all these difficult things. You then may be able to think back and have more positive, you know, in a positive light now, because you're in the context of your life being good.
Right.
Let's say that your life is bad. Then you may look back and think the same thing. It's like when you're dating someone and you get in a major fight with them, and then you think back to your relationship, you start to remember all the bad shit. Yeah. Or when things are great, then you start to think of all the good stuff. So that matters too, right?
So, then for you guys, I mean, I think we're all in very good spaces right now and lots of positivity around all of us. I mean, that doesn't change for me right now when I think back to childhood and like the memories. It still stays the same that I have a lot of these, you know, more traumatic memories. What about for you guys? When you guys think back, like a lot of your from 7 to 15 years old, you know, what are the memories that you have?
If I think of
right away, start thinking of stuff like that, positive stuff pop out?
If I think of a specific thing, like where I remember all the details, it's usually a bad thing. Mm-hmm. But if I think of a feeling, then it's good. Like if I think of my childhood growing up, I had a great childhood.
Yeah, like family. In general, yeah, it tends to be positive. But yeah, if I go to specifics, I can recall things that I wanted to improve. I think that's the biggest thing for me. I always look back at things that I screwed up or something happened that like I was like, ah, shit, like man, I got to do better at that. And like I'm always very like critical of like what I did when I was growing up. But yeah, for the most part, it's pretty positive. I think there's been a few that, you know, obviously stand out once I start thinking about like, you know, like people messing with me or something, you know, traumatic. That
I find that really interesting. It makes me like, you know, it's the Black Mirror episode, right? Where you could rewind and I wonder what that's going to be like for us, because we are definitely evolving to this point with the way we are connected to social media, the way we post, that somebody who's an IGener, like them in 20 years, they literally could technically, and for sure there's going to be lots of people that have this.
Yeah, you have a timeline since you're born now.
Right.
Of like any kind of media.
Yeah, of something that has a content that you've actually written, a picture that you've posted. Like it's going to be really, really interesting. And the fact that, so trip on this for a second. So we talk about how you are connected to some of the negative stuff or the traumatic stuff, and that's evolutionary. That's why that's why that makes sense, right? Like you said, to survive, right? That we would attach stuff. But when you look at the way people post on Instagram, what do you post on Instagram?
Well, that's different. That's because you want
everything is awesome.
So think about that. So now fast forward 20 years from now, and you're a 25-year-old.
So you think everything was awesome.
Right.
Yeah.
Now does that distort, you know, who you are? Because when you look back, you've only posted all your highlights of your life and none of the traumatic or the bad things.
Maybe.
Like, will that ultimately make us a happier society, or will it be you have a distorted view on yourself and life?
That's like, an interesting question. I don't know. Yeah. I'd have to think about that. I have no idea what that would be like. I think what's going to end up happening in the relatively near future is everything is going to be recorded, and not because you're writing it down and recording it yourself, but because it's literally being recorded.
Yeah,
where
like sensors everywhere.
Where you either have contact lenses on that record everything that you do, and trust me, the pragmatism of it, or at least the viability and how, like the utility of it would be amazing. Think about that.
Imagine, of course,
if you could record everything all day long. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't have to remember things. If you forgot something or what happened, if there was an accident, whatever, you could play back the camera and be like, here's what happened. This is what, it would be incredible.
You get everybody's point of view, and then you can really evaluate, you know, like who was at fault or who was, you know, like in the right, in whatever situation it was that required, you know, some kind of judgment.
Yeah,
on
it. I think that's what it's going to look. Now, I also think that's going to pose some problems.
Of course, where's the privacy then?
Well,
you know what I'm saying?
Well, people that can manipulate it too.
Oh, someone hacks your own video?
Yes.
And say, no, this is what happened.
Yeah. Ooh, well, you already see too, like what worries me is a lot of the videos now, like, it's so sophisticated they can take over people's, basically talk for
bro,
them.
Have you seen some of those?
Yes.
I saw
you
some.
You guys mentioned that. I haven't seen any.
Bro, like, I saw one where they took, Trump and they took Barack Obama, and they took real videos of them talking, like at a podium doing a speech. And then they use this technology to make them say other shit.
Yeah.
And you can't tell.
And think about that. Think about like some world leader or somebody speaking in front of a crowd. So they could be speaking in front of the crowd, but where's everybody else watching it? You know, on TV or like
right.
through some other media source. And so
right. There's literally 1,000 people in front of them, yeah, but so 10 million are listening.
It might be a completely different message than what was even delivered. And you know, and so it's crazy.
It's going to be crazy, but I also think at the same time there's a lot of natural checks and balances with that, right? Because now, even just today, anybody with a phone could record it and show people what actually happened.
Yeah, that is true.
So it's going to be a lot of responsibility on people. A lot of responsibility for us to kind of figure things out for ourselves rather than having other people tell us, you know, what to think.
Yeah.
I do have some interesting good news for you guys.
Oh, I like those good type
news.
Of updates.
It
might,
us up.
It might be good news.
Oh.
So apparently...
Backpedal.
Apparently, bread... The food that everybody loves.
Bread.
Is paleo. Bread is paleo.
Did they just acknowledge
so
that?
They just,
what the hell?
So scientists have just discovered the earliest evidence of bread.
Oh,
they actually found some black...
Some bread that's been around for fucking a million years.
They found some ancient stone building like...
it's all hard. It's like a brick.
Like artifacts or whatever. And they found...
They were making brick
food
oven
scraps.
Pizza.
No, they found food scraps. And the food scraps showed that there were bread, and the bread was 14,000 years old.
Damn.
So they've been making bread for a lot longer than we think.
Well,
then
weren't Egyptians making bread, or is that just, I mean, I know they were making some kind of beer.
I don't know. I don't know about that. But okay. But apparently bread has been around a lot longer than
we think. How are they proving that again? They actually found some bread that's been around for that long?
They find, of course, artifacts or whatever, and then they do, what is it called, carbon dating?
Mm-hmm.
Which is pretty effective, pretty accurate. And they found the bread to be 14,400 years old.
I thought there was a lot of room for error in carbon dating. I thought they proved that a long time ago that it was like,
It's not going to give you the exact date, but it's pretty accurate that it's over.
Really?
It's right around as old as they think.
So that's not true. So it's not true that could be, I heard it could be way off.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. But there you go. Now, it is important to note that, and that does kind of shit on the whole paleo advertising marketing theory or whatever, but it is important to note that the grains and shit that people were using back then are really nothing like the ones
different.
That we
For sure not for sure not. So I mean, isn't that what makes sourdough so great too, is that the how it's processed and or how
it's fermented
made. Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably how they did it back in the days too.
Part of it. The other thing is they you know, bread wasn't, they didn't use, I don't think they used yeast until later, so bread was probably flat. And they probably used other types of, it might not have been wheat, right? It might have been other cereal grains that they used. But here's the thing with the cereal grains. The reality is they are very nutrient dense and calorie dense for what they are. So it did provide, it was a boom for humanity. Even the, you know, of course the agricultural revolution exploded the world population.
Yeah.
So it's not all bad.
Right.
But what we eat now doesn't look like, you know, you ever seen a picture of ancient, like ancient wheat or ancient corn? Looks nothing
it's
like.
It's tiny. It's dude, like all different colors.
Ancient corn is like a spindle. It's like one single spindle with like a kernel here and there.
Sporadically.
Yeah. Versus this like starch bomb that just we have now, you know, that we've invented now. It's like
inflated yellow bubbly fucking balloon.
Yeah, no, it didn't look like that.
I would like to know how off like a lot of our nutrition books that we've been reading for a long time are, because I know like when I read, you know, when we read those books, right, and it goes through and you look at like an apple in fruit, like fruits and vegetables and all the things that are now genetically modified and have been over the last 50 plus years and 100 plus years, even that, right, where it's now like, okay, so what's an average apple according to my nutrition thing? Well, it says that it's 110 calories. Well, was that because they're...
When they first did it?
Yeah, like when they first did it was like this big, you know what I'm saying? Like the size of like a small...
Oh, yeah, like they kept those standards.
That's what I mean. Like, now I know this...
And food has changed a lot in like 40 years.
Well, selective breeding, I mean, too. Like we've taken we've harvested the best fruit and tried to duplicate it, too. So that's part of it. Like not just like we haven't been in a lab...
So take like a banana, for example, and I've done this, and a sweet potato. I've done this before. This was mind blowing for me when I first actually weighed this out and measured it, because I would used to go off before all the apps and all the cool shit.
Yeah, I would
out.
Just say one medium banana.
Right. Yeah.
Or
exactly. Or I'd say, you know, a sweet potato is, you know, X amount of carbohydrates or whatever. And I remember a regular size sweet potato being, you know, X amount of calories. And I just, you know, never really weighed and measured. If I was eating sweet potato, I just guesstimated that it was probably around there, give or take. And it was three times when I actually weighed it.
Oh, my God.
It was three times the amount of calories and carbohydrates than what I was assuming based off of what the old books were saying. So then it made me just go like, oh, bananas.
Yeah, you wonder how, like, when's the last time they, like, updated that and redid the whole standards?
And a lot of them were based off of, like, these, like, very, very small.
I doubt they're motivated to do that, unless they get money in that direction, which is not there.
So, like, why change it?
Have you seen, like, old Renaissance paintings of fruit and stuff like that from, like, a long time ago?
Yeah.
And there'll be, like, an apple, which is, like,
bananas, like, all seeds.
Yeah, it's, like, full of these fucking massive seeds, and they're small. I'm like, that's an apple?
Yeah. Yes. I bet it was like super tart and sour.
Yeah, it looks nothing like the sugar, you know, explosion that we have now.
And this is what really, because, you know, we know this as trainers, this has been said for a very long time. What do they say, that 80% of people underreport their food?
Oh.
So a lot of it, I think, it's not just their fault. They think they're, like, I think even the people, I think there's a large percentage of people that are reporting or tracking their food and think they're actually tracking correctly. And just don't realize that because they haven't taken it to the
detail. My calorie counter said one apple.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and it's like, okay, well,
that's two.
And your apple looks like this, right? Yeah. It looks like a fucking softball. It's like, apples used to look closer to golf balls than they did softballs. Shit. So
that's crazy.
So I wanted to ask you guys, if you guys use baby powder with your kids or ever around your house, did you see the big thing with Johnson & Johnson right now?
No, I don't.
Never use it.
I don't use baby powder.
Dude, check this out.
Is there
some shenanigans with that company?
Jury orders Johnson & Johnson to pay $4.7 billion in a Missouri asbestos cancer case.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yes.
Why?
They lost. So saying that the Johnson & Johnson, there was over 22 women who alleged the company... including its baby powder contain asbestos and cause them to develop ovarian cancer.
They put asbestos in their baby powder?
That's what it's saying.
What in the fuck?
That's
evil.
They lost, dude. $4.69 billion. Largest,
obviously,
largest
it holds
case
true because they lost.
Crazy, right?
Wow. No, pieces I don't. I never used baby powder.
22 women. Johnson, wow. Yeah, you know the fucking stock plummeted after that too.
Good. That's a massive company.
Yeah,
huge, massive company.
Huge, right? 500 says that.
So they found asbestos in the baby powder.
Yeah.
Mm. Wow.
That's inhumane.
Works when you burn, right? Puts out the fire. Sorry.
Nuts. Yeah, you have to get like special people to come to your house, just like in gloves and. They have to treat things a very specific way if they find even asbestos tiles.
Yep.
Like,
asbestos is safe as long as it doesn't start to flake. You know, so I mean, if it's just there, it doesn't do anything.
But it's in powder, so it's like...
Yeah, exactly.
So how? Why would you even use it in something like that? It doesn't make sense to me.
I don't know how that it could have possibly... Why is it connected to asbestos? Or is it the baby powder itself that caused the ovarian cancer? Like, why would they put asbestos in baby powder? That's strange.
That's what I don't understand either. It's a... I mean, this is just...
And the article doesn't say what.
This is where the conspiracy theorists are going crazy right now.
So this was on Apple News just like a day or two ago.
That's unreal, dude.
Yeah, July.
That actually makes me really angry.
July 12th. So this actually just happened.
And it doesn't say that they found asbestos in the baby powder? Oh, here we go. Doug just pulled something up. What does that say there, Doug?
Talc. Yeah, talc is mined. And so asbestos is found in the mined talc, which they use for talcum powder.
Oh. That's what it is.
I see.
So
maybe an unintentional, but still, like, they didn't do their due diligence and test it.
Yeah. Oh, shit. And how would you be able to tell, right?
Yeah.
You put that on babies, you fuckers.
I know. You fucking crazy, right?
Bastards.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Fuck.
Listen, you know, I tell people, go as natural as possible. Don't use shit like this. So these women were using baby powder on their vaginas because they thought it would...
Bro, I'm not going to lie. I would have never... I wouldn't think... The baby powder would even have something that could be compromising to it's baby powder. Yeah, I wouldn't think there would be anything.
Well, exactly, because we grew up with it and we think it's nothing.
Well, that's why
it's not even made from real babies.
Go down the rabbit hole, but I don't trust in their formulas. I don't none of that shit, dude. If it's not like natural,
scary, dude.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, if Johnson & Johnson is mining it and that's how it's made through this, what is talc? Does anyone know what that is?
Talc itself? Yeah, I don't know.
I have no
talcum
idea.
Powder, obviously, but I'm definitely not using anything on my balls anymore.
Some type of a mineral.
Yeah, so I would assume that all...
See, now that I know it's a mineral, it definitely doesn't make sense. Even putting talc on things, like, it doesn't make sense to put powdered minerals all over yourself all the time because you could potentially absorb some of it. It's like... It's like, the sunscreen. So I buy the sunscreen I use on my kids. I don't use the chemical stuff because that shit's
more zinc.
I use zinc oxide.
Yeah.
But I also make sure it's not nanoparticulized, which is where they take zinc and they crush it so much that you rub it in and you can't see it.
Because that way it'll penetrate.
Yeah, because the problem with the zinc oxide sunscreens is they leave a little bit of a white sheen.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that's how it works. It reflects things off. So then what companies did is they crush the zinc so small that you rub it in, you don't get that white sheen, but then they find, you absorb the zinc that way.
Yep.
So you got to be careful with the things you put on your skin, man.
So when you put the sunscreen on your kids, you use the stuff that's like it looks like paint is going on there.
If you put it on real thick, I do rub it in, but then when they get wet and sweaty, you can see they look kind of white.
Yeah, dude, remember the 80s? Remember put that on our nose?
Straight zinc, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm picturing.
I'll tell you what, it is way more effective at stopping sunburn. You put that shit on, you are not getting, it's very, very, because it reflects
all the lifeguards and everybody that were like in the sun, all the time, they were always putting that zinc oxide on them.
Because the other stuff is straight up xenoestrogens and these weird chemicals that are, endocrine, as Doug would say, disruptors.
So I wonder then how many of this baby powder stuff, we're picking on Johnson & Johnson right now, but is all powder?
I know.
Like a gold
bond. They got to look into it.
Gold
bond
and all these.
What do you think gold bond is?
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Who owns gold bond, by the way?
That's the brand, isn't it? Oh, no. It's owned by the same Arm & Hammer.
Arm & Hammer?
Oh, Arm & Hammer. Yeah, I think you're right.
I think that's who it is.
And I've used that too for powder.
I was just throwing it on my balls the other day.
No, you don't.
Yeah, that's why it made me think of this, bro. This is why it was a big deal to me.
You put Gold Bond on your nuts?
Well, sometimes if they're itchy.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I haven't done it very often, but I'll do it every now and then.
If they're itchy.
Have you ever thrown some baby powder on your nuts before you put them in your drawers?
Yeah. Get rid of that little swampy feel.
I mean, I don't want to recommend it to people now because, I don't want to give everyone cancer. But I mean.
Wow. Gold Bond body powders that contain talcum powder may increase the risk of ovarian cancer in women. Well, there you go.
Yeah.
That's another lawsuit now. There's a lawsuit apparently against...
Well, they probably haven't looked into testicular cancer and that tying into that either yet.
It's close to your butthole too, dude.
I don't know about you guys, but I mean, Justin being in a locker room a lot, that was a normal thing for all athletes, dude. That's definitely like a thing. You would throw some baby...
Because your girdle too, you'd have to wash, everybody used the same laundry and it was inevitably the back... I mean, it's gross, but... you know, like you'd use this powder to kind of make sure he kept all the bacteria at bay.
Well, the thing that you're trying to prevent is like jock itch, right? Which is a fungal infection. The best thing that you can do to prevent fungal infection, besides making sure that you're clean, you don't wear the same thing over and over again, is being healthy. Because when you have a healthy microbiome on your skin, because you have a microbiome in your gut, but you also have a signature microbiome on your skin. And when that's healthy, it naturally fights fungus. It naturally keeps it off. I know when I'm unhealthy, when my gut's off, I have more of a tendency to develop things like athlete's foot, for sure. For sure. So that's the most important thing. You know, these like throw powder on stuff and all that stuff. I feel
was
like a lot of that is...
when you were doing keto that you found yourself a little more susceptible?
So when I went keto, I'm not more susceptible to athlete's foot. But I went keto, okay. And then I took on top of it exogenous ketones. Mm. So I got my ketone levels fucking high through the roof. Mm-hmm. And when I would do that every time, I'd be more susceptible to athlete's foot. So I did some research and found that the fungus in athlete's foot actually can feed off of ketones.
Oh, interesting.
See, knowing all this stuff now always makes me curious to like what I was doing. Because when I was a kid, I remember I had athlete's foot for a little while in mm-hmm. high school, and then it's never, I've never seen it or ever had it mm-hmm. ever again as I got older.
It's pretty easy to get rid of, right? Myconazole and the, you know, tolfenate or whatever they're called, you know, antifungals over the counter. They're pretty effective. But
I use Monistat. Wait, is that the wrong stuff?
Monistat's for actually
yeast infections.
Actually, yeah, it still works.
That's for dirty vaginas,
actually,
bro.
It's not, bro. Shut up, bro.
It
still works, so man.
That's for dirty wizard sleeves.
It's dirty wizard.
Clean your dirty wizard sleeves.
Yeah, that's a good commercial.
Monistat.
We're not even sponsored.
We should be.
No, Monistat is myconazole. Same stuff that you'll use on athlete's foot or jock itch. Mm. Speaking of microbiomes, more research has just come out to show that they did a study on children with autism. And they took these kids and they did a fecal transplant where they were trying to give them a better internal microbiome.
Yeah.
And the symptoms of autism were relieved in many of these kids.
Oh, my God. That's crazy.
Like, big time.
What?
Yes.
That's awesome.
Yes, big time.
Whoa.
And we've known for a long time. Good news. Yeah, we've known for a long time that autism has been connected with gut issues like diarrhea, constipation, like all these other issues.
Right.
And they thought that there was some kind of a connection, but they weren't sure. So they took these kids, did the fecal transplant, and it was a small study, but they found that hyperactivity, repetitive actions, irritability, everything improved and continued getting better towards the end of the trial.
I'm gonna tell you something. That's the power of poo.
Yeah. No, dude, you know what?
Crazy though.
Let me tell you something. If you look at all the mild antibiotics we're exposed to, from the stuff that's in our soaps, like what's that? There's that one triclosan that was in soaps, right? The antibacterial soaps.
Yeah.
To the stuff that's in our tap water because people flush things down the toilet or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
To the chemicals that we use. To the fact that our environments are so sterile, and they're finding that the microbiomes of mothers and their children is becoming less and less diverse because it passes on to your child, then that child has children, and so on and so forth. I wonder if we're just starting to hit that breaking point where our microbiomes are so getting to the point where it's taken a few generations, but it's so fucked up that
it's been under assault.
Yeah, now, you know, food allergies, food intolerances, gut issues, mental issues, autism, all the stuff's exploding. It's all connected to the fact that our immune systems are just going haywire.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? From all the stuff.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Crazy.
Today's Quah is brought to you by MAPS Anabolic. If you're looking to maximize your overall muscle and strength, MAPS Anabolic is the perfect place to start. With a full 30-day money-back guarantee, there is absolutely zero risk. So what are you waiting for? Go to mindpromedia.com and get started today.
It's the motherfucking Quah.
The eagle has landed.
Quee Quah.
First question is from Mike Goes Fit. Is it possible for your muscles to grow but your strength to remain the same?
Yes, it is.
Absolutely.
It is, and I've experienced this myself. But before we go into the possible reasons, I think we need to talk about what strength is. There's a few components that we need to discuss with this. First off, the obvious one, your muscles, right? And bigger muscle fibers contract harder. And so when people think of strength, that's what they think of. They think muscles. Like, oh, I have bigger muscles. They're going to contract harder.
Right.
That's going to make me stronger. not necessarily true. Because
no, central nervous system.
Yeah, how they have a power source behind it.
How those muscles, how hard and quick those muscles fire, which is controlled by the central nervous system.
It's why I love your analogy that you started saying fucking years ago. It was the first time I ever heard anybody give that analogy. I think it's such a great analogy to get people to understand exactly how this works, which is the speaker and the amplifier analogy, because mm-hmm. you absolutely can go buy 12-inch subwoofers that should be, you know, theoretically more powerful than 8-inch subwoofers. But if you're not, you know, if you're not running a stronger amp, you won't really hear or notice a bigger difference in mm-hmm. it, and to me, that's how I think of like the difference between strength and, mm-hmm. and building muscle.
And part of that is also the fact that strength is also a skill. There is a lot of skill involved with being strong. Your ability to balance and fire muscles the way they should, how many times you've practiced a particular movement so your body knows that it can exert maximal force. Because here's the thing, like if you look at like a highly trained athlete, like an Olympic lifter, Olympic lifters are great examples of this. They're able to summon most of the strength that they're capable of for their lifts. They've trained so often and so many times that their body feels safe outputting all that power and strength.
Well, that's the reason why someone like Phil Heath would get his ass kicked by someone who's 180 pounds that's an Olympic lifter.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Because his body doesn't feel safe or used to being able to summon all his strength. Now, Phil Heath could summon all of his capable strength that his muscles could with good skill, he would be a lot stronger than he probably is in the gym. This is why sometimes people will be in emergency situations and find that they can summon strength that they normally didn't think they could. You know, the story of the mom lifting the car off her kid or whatever. There's some truth to that,
that's a good point too about being able to control it though. Because I mean, you can summon it and you could literally like deplete and exhaust your body.
Or hurt yourself
versus like somebody who's trained well and developed this skill knows the right exact amount and the dose and when to apply it, when to pull off of mm-hmm. it, and you know, in terms of like being the most efficient in that particular exercise. So there's a lot more that goes into it than just I can do this because my muscles are, you know, pulling this from the ground.
Yeah. Now, when I look at this question, it says, is it possible your muscles to grow but strength remain the same? What comes to mind right away to me is a lot of my peers in the competitive like bodybuilding world, this is really common where they, you know, they get this real bubbly looking muscles and they chase the pump all the time and they train in hypertrophy all the time. And so their muscles get bigger and they look bigger, but then they haven't really got that much stronger. So this is super common in mm-hmm. that space.
It is. It's like, okay, it's like you have a car that has 400 horsepower, but it's got a rev limiter. And we've set that rev limiter so that you're not able to exert all that horsepower. You try to push it, rev limiter kicks in, takes away your power, you know, engine kind of shuts you down. Your body has natural rev limiters. And many times what limits your strength is not because you're not strong enough, but it's because your body limits your strength because it's trying to protect mm-hmm. your body and your joints. Like if you have a certain amount of strength and you go to try throw a fastball or a baseball as fast as you can, many times what's limiting your speed isn't that you're not able to generate the speed, but the fact that your body won't let you because it thinks if you do, you're going to tear something.
Throw your arm off.
You're going to throw your arm off. And so a lot of strength is that skill, is that practice over and over again. This is why, you know, when at 195 pounds, you know, I had practiced deadlifts so many times. It was one of my favorite lifts. It's an exercise that I can go and grind out weight that guys that are 30 pounds heavier than me. And it's not because my muscles are stronger necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's because my body feels safe.
Well, you're better at that.
You've done it enough times to condition your body that you're going
to
be okay.
This is exactly. I was explaining this to Enzo yesterday because he was trying to, like, he's like, how come Sal is so much stronger on deadlift than you guys? Mm. And I'm like, Sal's
superhero.
Is this why you hurt yourself?
Yeah. No, this was just literally yesterday. I was having this conversation with Enzo and I just said, you know, Sal's been deadlifting since he was like fucking 15 years old. Like I literally started deadlifting at like 28. Like
way later.
Way later in my life. And not to take anything from him. I mean, but that just shows you how much.
Yeah, no, you've developed that skill to, mm-hmm. you know, a really high level. So that's just the difference.
It is. And so, and now here's the thing. Would you want more muscle and less strength? Well, I guess if you're just looking for the aesthetic and you really don't care about strength, then that's fine. But here's there is
you
a potential.
You want to be a walking balloon animal?
Yeah, and here's
go for it. Easy, but there, easy. There is for a very.
But there is a benefit
for
though.
A very long time.
All show no go.
For you know, hashtag. Yes, for a very long time, I was this guy. Like I used to pride myself on going to the gym.
What was your saying? Like when I take my shirt off in the bedroom, girl doesn't ask me how much I can bench.
Yeah, it's right. It's true. You know, they
boom.
So I was.
Imagine if a girl did do that once though. Yeah. Wow, you look good. What's your deadlift?
Yeah, she's like, oh, that's 100 pounds less than me.
Yeah. I got a bench over there in the corner.
I was all show, no go. But here's, if that's your goal, like is to, in which let's be honest, okay, fucking at least half the people listening to this show right now, if not more, dude, that's they just care about the way they look.
Plus, here's the other, here's the real benefit though, because I'm going to side with you, but here's the real benefit, Adam. It's not so much that people just want to look good and don't really care about the strength, although that's true. The real benefit is training for maximal strength is way riskier. Than just training to build muscle.
This is where I was heading with this. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So I trained 4 years being the all show, no go guy and just trying to look cool. And I used to pride myself on being the guy who would walk over next to the dude grunting and groaning and throwing up crazy weight with terrible form.
Veins just popping.
Right, and I would come over with my real light baby weight, you know, and get this, you know, but look ripped and jacked and be, you know, exercising, balancing or doing weird shit. And so that was my thing. Now here's... The deal is when I switched over to strength training, I saw some major gains. Like I definitely saw my body change. I saw the look of my muscles. There's a lot of positive things like I remember sharing this on the show years ago was I liked that I didn't have to be pumped up to look bigger and stronger. I know the strength training gave me, and we've talked about this.
Dense muscle.
Right. We've speculated on like, does it actually look different? Does that muscle fiber like look different to the average person? I believe so. I believe that strength training gave me these dense, hard muscles that don't need to be aired up to look good. So there was a lot of positive stuff. Now the negative stuff is I've been hurt more in the last 5-6 years strength training than I ever did.
Promotes a lot more stress around the joints.
Right.
I mean, there's no denying that at all.
So, I mean, when I was the all show, no go guy and all I cared about is looking pretty and shit, I mean, there's definitely some positives to that as far as, you know, being safer. And you still can build a very incredible physique as far as the way it looks. Like, absolutely, I was getting killed if you compared me to a strength athlete or an Olympic lifter or someone like that. But you could build an incredibly aesthetic physique without ever being somebody who chases like heavy.
That's right. I learned this myself, you know, years ago because I always loved strength. I wasn't a power lifter or anything like that, but I just like being strong. And so I always tended to train to get stronger. And then there was one point where I started to change my training a little bit and I was just getting good pumps and just focusing on that for a second. And I was, oh, you know what it was? It was the first time I actually got myself really, really lean and dieted. And you know, when you go into calorie deficit and you're trying to diet, you're not going to be as strong, or at least it's difficult to be strong. Mm-hmm. So I mentally had to make the switch and say, it's okay that I'm not as strong as I normally am. So because of that switch, I started training differently. And I noticed that I was kind of getting bigger in certain parts of my body without getting stronger. And it really tripped me out. I was like, oh shit, like I can actually look bigger or build a little bit of muscle without getting stronger. So it's definitely true. Absolutely true. You can do it. I think there's some benefits sometimes to training just for muscle. And that benefit comes in the form of safety, 100%. Like training heavy and pushing for strength all the time. I mean, you can do it in a safe way and you can prime properly. You can check your ego. But no matter what, at the end of the day, it's still higher risk for injury.
Next question is from James Hammer. What is the worst injury you've experienced and what did you do to recover from it?
That's easy.
Yeah. Well, for you, right?
Yeah, yeah. I'm going through it for sure.
The Achilles was the worst one?
Yeah.
Why? Just because it took the longest?
Yeah. I mean.
Because you had Achilles tear.
Yeah. I've had ACL, MCL stuff too. I really haven't been injured that much. I've never had a broken bone. I've never had stitches. So I haven't been injured a lot. I've had a cracked coccyx. You know, I crashed.
Whoa.
Yeah. Yeah, not a cock.
Oh, that's the one in the back. Yeah, that's the one in the back.
That's my tailbone, right? So
that sucks, by the way. I heard that.
It does. I got a blood clot from it afterwards, too, because so I crashed my ATV on this.
Oh, you told us what's long
time ago. I was hitting a tabletop jump on my buddy's ATV, and he has a wrist throttle instead of a thumb throttle, and I just wasn't used to riding. As I was going up the jump, I leaned back and that naturally broke my wrist and I broke it down and it throttled it down and I took off and the ATV started to do a backflip in the air me on it and I'm about
you and all Travis Pastrana all of a sudden.
Dude, and I kicked off, I bailed, and came flat on my, landed flat on the dirt on my back and on the top of a tabletop jump, probably a good 10, 15 feet up in the air.
It didn't, you're lucky it didn't land on you.
No, well, yeah, I kicked. So as soon as I started to go back and up, like it was going to go upside down, I pushed off of it. I mean, I felt it going that direction and bailed. And I just landed straight on it. It was one of the most painful things that I had gone through. They were talking about trying to fly me out. And I'm like, no, I can get out. And on the way back to the house, we had to stop at the hospital because all of a sudden I lost the complete feeling in my right leg. Like, just didn't feel it anymore. The reason why I didn't was that the swelling in my back got so big it must have pinched a nerve.
Oh,
and
then, shit.
But I was like freaking out. Like, all of a sudden, I mean, literally no feeling. So to be like, oh, in pain.
And you're thinking paralyzed.
Oh, yeah, right away. I'm thinking. Yeah. So I get so scared. We get in the hospital. And then they get some ice on it, so that brings the swelling down. I start to feel the feeling back, so I was okay. And then the doctors pretty much said, sorry, they did x-rays, said we can't really do anything for you. So here's some drugs, here's a donut.
Is it all off now? Do you have like a? Because I know no, if it cracks, it'll heal weird sometimes. Yeah,
well, it does feel like it. Like, I haven't gone back years later to go x-ray to see how much.
A little tail?
Like how, what, like what it feels. But I can definitely feel, like even this latest back That's injury that I just did, it definitely always hurts in that area. Like, it, I can feel like if I have like little minor stuff, like muscle related,
yeah,
it's still, I can feel it.
Kind of, I hate tailbone shit.
So yeah. that was a gnarly one. And because I was in so much pain and I was on this donut all day long, what ended up happening was, because I was sitting around all day, I ended up getting this blood clot, and I had like a softball sized blood clot in my back, and they had to go out, I had to drain it, and that was a big deal. So that was pretty painful.
Ew.
But it's even
that sounds worse than your Achilles.
No, dude. That, I mean,
you don't think maybe your Achilles feels worse because you were also simultaneously going through the low testosterone, not training.
Well, I'm
depression. Maybe.
I mean, I'm sure that exaggerated, right, or amplified the feeling or whatever of not liking or thinking it was one of the worst injuries. But I definitely, I mean, the fact that it's 8 months later and I still have days where I don't
feel.
That's
true. It's a long time.
Yeah, no, it's a long time to be dealing with an injury still, and I don't. You know, I don't bitch about it all day long, but it's fucking uncomfortable as shit. It doesn't feel good. Like, I've never had something linger for this long. Mm. And even, again, back to the other injuries, the MCL, ACL, you know, after they went in, scoped that out, yeah, I was in pain for a month or so. And then once it healed, it was a little awkward for a while. I lost all my muscle. All that shit sucked. But the nagging pain and what I've dealt with the Achilles has trumped pretty much anything and everything else that I've been through.
Yeah, I've had stitches as a kid and all that stuff, but one of my first major injuries was dislocating my left patella, my kneecap. And this was when I was maybe 12, I think I was 12 or 13, playing volleyball with the family at the park, and I jump and I landed in the grass.
I've seen that.
Huh?
Just seeing you play volleyball.
Oh, it's incredible.
Yeah. Just be neat to watch.
Just running for it and diving. Yeah.
No. I
so
went
gracefully.
You know what happened?
Wisping his hair.
My foot landed.
I got this, boys.
In a hole, and I twisted my knee, and my kneecap went out, and I hit the ground, and it sounded like a dry crack, which was kind of weird. Yeah. And then I looked down, and it didn't hurt at first. And I looked down. I couldn't straighten my leg out. Like, I couldn't get up. I'm like, what? And I looked down, and my kneecap was here.
Ew.
So like the back of my the back of my leg. So imagine, like, you see my kneecap here.
Damn, it rotated over that.
Where'd it go?
It was here, and my skin was all stretched out to accommodate for it. So it just looked fucking crazy. And I'm like 12 or 13. I'm on the floor, and I start screaming. Ugh. And I start screaming the worst obscenities you've ever heard in your life around my entire family. Like, fuck, bitch, cunt, mother. And so my cousin, everybody runs over, like, what's going on? And my cousin's looking at me, and he's like, he starts whispering in my ear. He's like, you're saying really bad words.
He's like,
you're saying really, really bad words. But I couldn't help it, man. I was just cussing like crazy. Ambulance came. They took me in the ambulance. And then as we're driving, and they give me all this morphine, they're like, okay, the closest hospital, we can take you to it, but your insurance, it's not a Kaiser hospital. I had Kaiser insurance. So my mom looks at me, and she's like, what do you want to do? And I'm like, all right, go to the one that's far away. It's like 40 minutes away. So I had to like drive my ass. We had to take us. Yeah, 40 minutes. So that was kind of bad. And then I wore this leg brace that where I couldn't bend my leg.
Yeah, those are annoying.
And I walked around in that thing for, I don't know, 2-3 months. And this is why my left calf to this day is bigger than my right calf. Mm. Till this day. It was trigger sessions all day long on my left calf. And I think I did some hyperplasia because my right calf will not catch up to my left. And the reason why I walk so much on it is I also started dating this girl that lived, I don't know, 2 miles away. And this is the first time a girl ever gave me like a hand job.
Oh, right.
So I would walk for two miles.
It was worth it.
I didn't give a fuck, man. I had a straight leg brace. It was in summer.
The things that teenage boys will do for a hand
for
job.
For a hand job?
Oh.
I would have crawled on my stomach.
Even if it was through the pants at that point. You know what I mean?
Oh, it was everything.
Like, did I ever share this story? So after I had the surgery on the knee, I was in one of these braces also. And the most painful moment of my life was during this time. So it was
when you tried to go bend it?
So it was before the surgery. They put me in this brace. So I had surgery scheduled like a week or two later, but then I had this foam stiff-legged brace thing they had. So there's a little bit of play in it, but it kept me in this fixed position. You know, and it was really annoying to do things like go to the bathroom. And I'll never forget this. So if you can imagine, I'm sitting on one of those, you know, elevated, I'm in the handicap stall, and I've got the bar next to me. I sit down and I'm taking a shit, right? And I got my leg locked out straight in front of me. And the toilet seat did one of these. So when I reached back to go wipe myself, the seat slid.
Pivoted a bit?
Yeah, the seat slid just a little bit. And then that 1 inch drop, it dropped.
It caused you to bend your knee.
It did that with my leg that is still injured.
It's like a wrestling move.
Oh, yeah. And I felt it tear a little bit more. And I'm just screaming, crying. And this is at 24 Hour Fitness back when I worked there. And I'm crying inside the stall.
You gotta tighten up your seats, bro. It's your gym too, fucker. It's your fault.
People inside, are you okay in there? Are you okay? Yeah. I'm gonna be okay.
No, this shit was horrible.
That was that. And then when I went to Paris right after that, before I had done the surgery, and I was hobbling around in Paris and hooked it on a cobblestone that was sticking out. And went the same direction.
That's terrible.
It buckled me to the ground those two times. Well, probably the most painful.
So my other bad injury was in my other knee, and I was in jiu-jitsu, and there was a guy that was the coach, or the guy that was teaching the class, cool guy. And whenever we would, on the ground, he would kill me because he was a teacher. But stand up, when we would do stand up and throws, I have a judo background, and so I would do pretty well against him. And so we start doing stand up, and he goes to jump guard, because this is what a lot of jiu-jitsu guys do when they don't want to get thrown. They'll just jump guard. So he goes to jump guard. I'm getting ready to pivot to do a throw, so it's like really bad timing. My foot's on the ground. He just jumped on my knee. His whole weight just, and I heard my knee go cluck cluck,
like it made it, seriously, like inverted.
And I'm like, for sure, I look like a flamingo. Like it went backwards, God, like a flamingo. And I thought, for sure, I tore my knee. Like, for sure, I didn't
bounced back.
I got MRI'd and everything, and they're like, and I'm like, I told them like, oh, you tore my knee. This 100%. Nope, didn't tear it.
That's crazy.
And then the third worst injury, pulling the first time I deadlifted or pulled 600 pounds off the floor was with a trap bar. Which I can lift roughly about 35 to 45 more pounds in a trap bar than I can a straight bar. I don't know if you guys ever tested that to see.
That's probably.
And
about
so,
right.
And the thing I like about a trap bar is it helps get me used to a particular weight before I go to the straight bar, so I could feel what 600 pounds is like. So I put 600 pounds of the bar, and I'm grinding and pushing through, and at the very top of the lift, my rib came out, big pop, boom, right in my back. I put the weight down. I laid down on my back, and I couldn't move for, I don't know, an hour and a half. And I couldn't breathe either for like the first 10 minutes.
I've had ribs out. You can't breathe. It's real restricted.
And I was like, am I going to pass out right now? What's going on? That's it for me.
Yeah, dude. I mean, I've had a plethora of injuries, but they're all like when I was younger, like for the most part. Like I did it all like through childhood. I mean, which is kind of crazy because I went and I played rugby. I played football. You know, it's like super high impact sports. But the worst that I got from those sports was like I had like a MCL tear. And then that was like my senior year. And then before that, it was a plethora of concussions, which totally don't count.
Hold on a second. You had a plethora of concussions?
No, I had three. I had three obvious ones where I was like, that was bad. That was bad.
So what happens? Did you get knocked out or did you just forget?
No, like I still wanted to play because I was an asshole and, you know, didn't want to listen to the doctor. But like they do that test where they ask you like questions that are, you know, whatever, who are you, what's your name, like who, the president, you really know, whatever
hard,
they come
really
like,
hard
real
ones.
Hard ones that I screwed up because like it's funny, you ever talk to somebody who had a concussion, it's like talking to somebody who's like super super drunk, you know, it's really
like,
weird, it's bizarre,
like a slur or whatever,
yeah, like you just say like really random weird shit and like your brain is on a totally different path.
Do you remember what it felt like when you got the concussion?
more that I was totally discombobulated. Like I just didn't know, like I didn't have any bearings. Like I didn't know where I was. Like, and so they took me to the hospital after this one game, and I had made like, it was like one of my best games. I had like, I like made the sack. I sacked the quarterback in the end zone, got like, you know, 2-point conversion or a safety. And then like right after that, like I was going on kickoff and I shouldn't have gone for the ball. Like it kicked it. You're never supposed to go for the ball if it goes over your head, right? You're supposed to let the guys behind you get it. Mm. And it was like really close to me. And so I just turned and grabbed the ball and caught it and then turned in, which is another thing you're not supposed to do. You're supposed to turn out. And I turned into like a, you know, they call them like wedge breakers. And there's like three of them that all tackled me.
And they're running at
my head, full speed, full sprint. So that one was
I'm assuming you let go of the ball too then after that.
No, I held on to it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Just knocked out on the ground.
Yeah, I just got clobbered, dude.
Did you get knocked out or were you just, you got up and you were just woozy?
I mean, I saw stars and like probably briefly got like, you know, blacked out for a minute, but no. But yeah, and I mean, my arm, so growing up, I had two right arm breaks in the same year. That was the worst. So I basically like, broke my arm the first time I was on monkey bars and fell off like this really tall monkey bar.
Like every 80s kid.
Yeah. Like I feel like that's a rite of passage. Yes. You know, like you fall off the monkey bars, you break your arm. And then like the end of the year, it was like probably like 6 months later, 7 months later, this kid, I was playing with my brother's friends and this kid just like pushed me in a ditch and I landed on a rock and fucking broke it all over again.
Oh,
so I got really good at doing things with my left hand. And so for like maybe 2 years or so after that, I was like ambidextrous. I could throw a ball with my left hand, like all that kind of stuff. And
there's a boxer that an old school boxer, old time boxer. I want to say Jack Dempsey. I'm not sure who it was, but he, same thing. He broke his arm and then learned how to hit really, really well with his other hand and then mm-hmm. became a really, really good boxer as a result.
It's interesting. Yeah. I wonder if that helped me at all. But like, yeah, I was pretty balanced, you know, like mm-hmm. going into sports after that. Like I didn't have any injuries. It was kind of crazy.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Next question is from 4A Schneider. What do you guys think about the latest steroid use in CrossFit and the transparency they are showing? Will that be a good or a bad thing for the growth of the sport
so
of fitness?
I'm totally
so what's
unaware,
going on with
yeah,
this?
Yeah, I'm totally unaware of this right now.
Are they calling people out? Are they
did
testing
somebody
them?
Get busted or?
Yeah, I think, I mean, there was a T Nation article that was highlighting it too. It's like sort of the elephant in the room that now is like kind of surfacing as far as like the usage is been reported like all over the place.
Do you know if they even, like
do they test them
yeah,
for competition?
Do they even test?
So that's a good question. We should probably pull that up. I didn't get the, you know, the CrossFit standards as far as like when they get into the games.
Because I've never heard anyone get tested before. I didn't think the games was tested. I don't know.
Oh, like, no, they're taking tests.
Yeah, they're taking tests now?
Yeah, okay. I just pulled up an article right now. 5 2018 Reebok CrossFit Games athletes, including Emily Abbott, failed drug tests. So CrossFit headquarters just released the full list of regionals athletes in breach of CrossFit's drug policy.
Oh, shit. Emily Abbott's a big
name,
too. Who else?
So let's find out.
Let's write them all.
Well, yeah. Like Froning and all those guys.
You know what? Come on, dude. Of course they're all going to.
Like, well, I know. I'm just. And the thing is, it's such a new sport. It doesn't surprise me that it would go into that direction first and then they'd have to kind of scale back.
Okay,
because
here we
it's
go.
Like, if you're competing against somebody who is, you know, why
Emily
why
Abbott.
You?
Yeah, Emily Abbott, 4-year sanction. Whoa, 4 years banned. Well, good for them, man.
Yeah.
So that's she got tested positive for ibutamarin. Never heard of that anabolic agent. Ibutamarin. We need to look that up. Dean Shaw, clomiphene. So he was taking Clomid. So now people are wondering, well, what? And that's a selective estrogen receptor
that's
modulator.
That's post, right?
Yeah, so he must have gone off
so
to try and pass
and
the test.
When you hear stuff like that, and they get popped for like Clomid or something, it makes me always wonder like how many of these guys and girls are running it a majority of the year, but then
and then cycling off.
Yeah, and
of
this
course,
is like right before this is just the person who gets
bro. Look what they're getting caught.
It's just like any
for.
Sport, though. You know, any professional sport.
A lot of people got banned because they were taking SARMs, yeah. Osterin. GW1516. Wow. Other than Winstrol. This guy's taking Winstrol. What an idiot. Everybody knows Winstrol like will stay in your blood forever. Or maybe not. Maybe not everybody knows. Exogenous testosterone.
I don't know that.
You know what? This is good. I'll tell you why this is good. If you want your sport to be mainstream and also to separate itself from I think it's brilliant. I think the UFC, honestly, I think raised the bar for that. Like, the UFC takes it very seriously.
They're going, like, super, super crazy detailed with the way that they test, and USADA comes in and like, on a whim, you know, that they'll test you. So it's, and that's the thing about sport. It's, you want to portray, especially if you want to legitimize your sport, you want to have like people behind it. And so you want like kids to play your sport and kind of grow up and perform the sport. And you want to maintain that purity as much as possible. But when you get to like, you know, the people that are doing it for their profession, they're getting paid to do it.
Now, I've always wondered why we don't have, just like we do with, you know, bodybuilding, why do you not have like an all natural league and a natural league?
Yeah. Well,
I like that as an option.
Why not have a really strict, like extremely strict, you know, rules for steroids for the, you know, on, you know, the league that it does not have steroids, and then you have a league that allows steroids.
You know what's going to be funny about this? What? So this reminds me of when the UFC bought Pride. You guys remember Pride?
Yeah.
Okay, so Pride was this MMA organization in Japan that notoriously did not test people for drugs, and in fact, there were rumors that they would actually give them to their athletes. So when, and there was always this,
Pride
there was always this debate, like, you know, who would win, you know, in a fight, the top Pride fighter or the top UFC fighter? Like, you know, Pride had like Vanderlei Silva. They had, what's his name?
Mirko
Krokop.
For a minute, yeah.
They had, you know, Fedor Emelianenko. Like, yeah. And then UFC, you had, you know, people like, what's his name?
Chuck Liddell.
And all, right. So, you know, Randy Couture. And they would always debate who would win. And when the UFC bought Pride, it was like, oh, now we're going to know. We're going to see, right?
Right.
And the craziest thing happened. Like, Vanderlei Silva.
All the Pride guys lost 30 pounds.
Dude.
Yeah.
Like, Vanderlei Silva, Pride versus Vanderlei Silva at UFC does not look the
same.
Totally
different human.
Not at all. And what's that one kickboxer guy? Tall dude. The Dutch kickboxer guy. Black dude.
Oh,
fucking awesome.
Yeah.
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
The K?
No.
Kong.
No. He used to fight in K1.
Yeah.
He was really, really good. Good looking dude. Dutch guy.
Ah, God. You get me again.
You know who I'm talking
about. Starts with a B. It's, I can't think of his name right now.
Anyway, if we look up like some of the top, he just got knocked out recently, I think, in a fight. Anyway, he looked super jacked when he was in Pride. Like, insane. Looked like an amateur bodybuilder. Comes to UFC. All of a sudden, he looks like just lean, kind of skinny fighter or whatever. It's hilarious. It's going to be funny to see what happens at CrossFit.
Didn't Belfort come from there, too?
Belfort. Yes. Belfort was another one.
Yes.
That guy looked like a bodybuilder.
Yeah, he was crazy.
Jacked.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, he looked like a kind of, you know, like a fit, normal fit dude.
Yeah.
So I wonder if that's going to happen with CrossFit now that they're testing and now that they know that they're serious because they just banned a bunch of people.
Well, think about how, you know, like as far as steroids, like helping with recovery. I mean, that's the biggest thing with CrossFit because, I mean, you're just going through fucking hell the whole time you're competing.
I would argue that CrossFit of all the sports, would it be the most advantageous?
I feel that
Alistair Overeem.
Yes, Overeem. Overeem. Oh my God, he was like a giant.
Bro, if you pull up, maybe Doug can pull up. Look up Alistair. It's here. I'll send you a picture of this, Doug. Alistair Overeem Pride, and then we'll look him up. Alistair Overeem UFC.
But
look at the difference. It's like 40 pounds.
What do you guys think? I mean, this is total speculation, but I would think that steroids in CrossFit would be the most advantageous in comparison to any other sport that's out there. When you think of like the level of these guys, a lot of these guys are doing like your top guys.
Are there weight classes in CrossFit?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, well, there you go.
Yeah.
You know, then in that case, it's probably going to be a huge benefit, right? Because you gain a little bit of weight because you're stronger. You don't have to worry about your weight class.
Right. Yeah. And then on top of that, too, you think of the recovery. Like Justin said, some of these guys or girls are doing three times a day doing these CrossFit workouts.
Yeah, how are you gonna like bounce back after all that damage you're applying?
Average human being just can't recover from
that. You can't do that.
Mm-mm. No, and I that's what I'm saying. I wonder what they're going to look like, what the fighters are going to look like, or excuse me, what the competitors are going to look like now that the testing is more serious. Yeah, look at the difference.
He's a beast.
See how he looked right there on that in the right versus, you know, the one on the left or whatever?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can add like 30 pounds to the guy. Yeah, and I wonder if the records are going to stay now. You know what I mean? Because some of these records were set when there was no drug testing. And now that there's drug testing, are these guys even going to be able to compete?
Well, and then you bring up what the study that you brought up, which I find fascinating, and I believe because somebody who has taken anabolics consistently before and then have been off now, I mean, I definitely feel like I've kept
maintained. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot, you know, of that muscle.
Not all of it.
Muscle memory,
yeah,
at least.
But a decent amount of it for sure. I mean, I don't, I think if I would have remained a kid who never touched anabolics, I think the pace that I was going on was being somebody who probably weighed somewhere between 180 to maybe at the top 200 pounds, where, you know, I'm comfortably over 210 plus. And it's been quite some time now. So that's the other thing, too. It's like, well, fuck, what about these people that run this in the off season hardcore and then just get off?
See, my whole thing is I'm just glad that this stuff's coming out, because I always push for the transparency of it. Like, don't portray yourself as being like this awesome,
natural.
And because kids are watching what you're doing, and like, this is like gaining popularity, and like, you know, just be honest. If you're doing it, then be honest with, that's fine. But like, don't like try and portray yourself as this, like, you know, like that, I just got gifted with
that's
all this
how
athleticism.
I've always felt. I don't shame anybody, obviously, yeah. Because yeah. I have.
It's well, here's the other thing to look at now. Now, I understand why UFC went crazy with their drug testing, or why they took it so seriously. These guys are hitting each other. And the last thing you want is to, if someone get hurt, and then, you know, so I understand why they're doing it.
Yeah, there's more like real damage.
Now, there could be an argument that for CrossFit, if they had just not tested and just said, hey, it's in our policy, but not tested, it's not a sanctioned sport. Mm-hmm. You know, they're testing themselves. Like, maybe it would help ratings to have a bunch of jacked, you know, athletes doing crazy shit. Because it's a spectator sport, too.
Of course, sure.
You know?
Of course it would.
So it might
as
actually
fans,
hurt.
As fans, people love that more. It's obvious.
It might actually hurt
gladiators.
Their business.
Yeah.
I mean, I absolutely think it will.
Yeah.
I mean, look what happened to baseball. What happened to baseball they started popping everybody for juice, and then they saw the home runs going down. There's a lot of people speculating. I brought it up on the show, about 6 months ago or more ago.
Oh, they're messing with the ball.
Yeah,
now.
Because they're trying to figure out how. I mean, people just like to see home runs, man. People want to see the ball.
At the end of the day, they got to make money.
That's right. So, I mean, yeah, if CrossFit starts to see all the strength go down.
Plus, when they lose their top athletes who are pulling a lot of fans in for 4 years.
Yeah.
That could be a killer for
the and most of the ones that are have the highest like social media following and stuff are the ones that are
and sometimes it's better to not say something, because now they're bringing it to light. So now the average person watching CrossFit is going to be like, oh my god, all of them take steroids. You see, they busted all when they don't test anybody. Then you still have that debate, like, well, they're probably natural. They could be natural. I don't know. I don't think they take steroids. They're not bodybuilders, you know.
Right.
It might have been a bad decision for that in that sense.
Next question is from Hecka Stubborn. What are some of your favorite functional exercises for experienced lifters who want to get more into that kind of training?
Hecka, come on. I hate that. Just say Hella.
Yeah. Hecka.
Favorite functional exercises. I don't know if this, the one I'm going to name
can
here.
I was just going to say, how are we going to classify functional?
I'm thinking
what's
of.
What's not functional?
I'm thinking of, exact good point. I'm thinking exercises that are not mainstream, that are ones you don't typically see.
So let's use that word instead. I hate the buzzword functional, because everything's could be considered functional, right? So it's
right. A deadlift is massively functional.
What are what are some not common exercises that I think are biggest bang for your buck?
One for me is the Zercher squat. Zercher squat, I totally took for granted. Didn't think it was that big of a deal. Then I started doing them on a regular basis, because I'd done them here and there, but I'd never trained them consistently. Watching my strength gains go up on it, and then watching what happened to my body, in particular my my posterior chain, my mid back, and even my arms, even just holding a weight in the crook of my elbow really heavy, I developed like some more muscle and strength from it. And I can see it now it's now part of my routine. In fact, Jessica does Zercher squats every week, because she said she really feels it in her glutes, and that's always an area she's trying to target. So that would be one of my top ones.
I have two unconventional lifts that I think have been game changers for me. And one of them is the Bulgarian split squat.
Mm-hmm.
Hands down, for my lower body, has been one of the biggest. I mean, not just strength, but it's also, I've seen the difference in my mobility. It's improved my squat. I mean, it grew my legs. It has been huge for me. So Bulgarian split squat, that one, and then the Z press. The Z press has been a movement that I love to teach people, and
it gets my shoulders pumped. It's like silly.
It does. It gives you, and then also it promotes good core strength, good thoracic mobility, good shoulder mobility. You can't cheat the movement. It's a really tough exercise. Like so many exercises, you know, that you can cheat your way through. It's, you know, it's tough. Like, this is a movement that you just, you can't fucking cheat.
It's in map split.
You have to grind your way through.
I've been doing them because it's phase two.
Those two fucking movements, man, hands down, I always make sure that I've incorporated into my routine. Even if it's a program that we don't have it in, I still find a way to put those in there.
Yeah, I think for me, definitely like the windmill or bent press would be up there, just because
100%.
It shows me like where, like, so I get really stiff and I get like restricted, you know, in my lower back and just, you know, in general, my thoracic, you know, rotation's terrible. So it's like something that I like to make sure that like I keep, you know, checking up on. You know, it's not like I'm always doing that like in the programs, but I'm definitely doing that to kind of check up and see like where I'm at. And how I can, because it's such a lift that like you wouldn't do, you know, throughout the day.
It's an awesome lift.
So that's one of them for sure. And the other one, I know it's kind of obvious that I'm kind of like the rotational guy, but, why I love like mace bell training and doing these like 360 swings, like all the time. And so frequently it fucking bulletproofs my shoulders. Yeah. Like I literally have not felt any shoulder pain, and shoulder pain was a big deal. Like that was something that would always limit me. Once I would increase my lifts or like get to a certain level, I could never break through until I started doing rotational type exercises. You never see anybody do it in the gym. You know, you don't see people swinging things around or using their arms like a whole nother way. Like throwing a baseball or throwing something is a natural movement that we've evolved to do.
So. I have to jump on board with you at that. You are the one that got me into the clubs and the mace. And I've now, it's been long enough that I've been using them where I've had stretches where I've been very consistent with it and I haven't been consistent with it. The minute that I am off and I'm not being consistent with the mace and the Indian clubs, when I go to do any sort of bench press, I get this pinch and this pain in my shoulder.
Exactly.
And it's that scary, oh God, if I go a little bit heavier, I'm going to do some damage here. And so it always would, it would limit me from pushing heavier weight. When I'm being consistent with the clubs and the mace, completely gone.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me, and so I'm glad you went the rotational way, because I wish I would have thought about that, because the bent press and the clubs and mace are definitely three things that I've now incorporated into my routine that just were not a movement that I would do that much, because I have had the opportunity to be consistent with it and be without it, and I can see the difference that it's made on me for sure.
I like going through old bodybuilding books and finding old exercises that people don't do anymore, just because whenever you try a new movement, especially ones that were established a long time ago, like the bent press, right? The bent press and windmills were staples in old strongman training. In fact, the bent press was a feat of strength. It was in a lot of their acts.
Oh,
and
it was regarded. It's just like the bench press of today, basically.
Right. Nobody did a bench press, actually.
That's back what I mean. That was like, you know, how much you bench. Yeah, like it was like
nobody did barbell squats and nobody did bench presses back in the day. And the problem was how to get the bar in position. That's why they never did them. There were no squat racks. So if you wanted to do a squat, you had to be able to clean a weight, put it on your back, and then do a squat. If you wanted to do a bench press, you had to be able to get the bar, bring it up above your body, lay down on something, and then press it up. So the bench press hadn't been invented, and neither had the squat rack, or at least it wasn't widely in use. So I like looking back and looking at some of these old exercises, and then even old exercises of like the 60s and 70s, like Zottman curls. Zottman curls are great for arm development, or incline lateral raises. You guys ever do an incline lateral raise? You ever seen the old school bodybuilding one where you're laying down on an incline on your side and you're kind of bringing the dumbbell to your front and coming outside?
Well, you and sissy squats. I mean, honestly, I never did sissy squats until you kind of turned me on to those.
So. Oh, I love sissy squats for quad development. So I always recommend
if you put a workout together that consisted of all the movements that we just said, like literally put that together as a routine, it'd be a fucking killer routine. We're missing a little back stuff, so that's everybody nailed some really good anterior stuff. We didn't do any posterior stuff there. So
good mornings an old school exercise. You're starting to see people do it now, but 5 to 10 years ago nobody did a good morning. Actually, if you bent over like that with a bar on your back,
people think you're fucking
they freak you out. Oh my god, you're gonna hurt yourself. But that was an old school exercise. That
great movement, advanced as fuck.
If you know how to do it,
great move it, advanced as fuck.
Yep, absolutely. Hey, check it out. We have guides that are free. Some of them teach you how to build your legs. Some of them teach you how to get a flat midsection. Some of them teach you how to do HIIT training properly. There's a lot of guides. There's 12 of them. All you gotta do is go to mindpumpfree.com, download all of them. They cost nothing. Check them out.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.